All right, now we're joined by Charlie Wiggins, who's running for re-election to the Supreme Court position 6. So go ahead with a 2-minute introduction.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the opportunity to be here and to share a few words with you. I appreciate what you do. It's so important, particularly in judicial races where folks sometimes have difficulty finding enough information and your evaluations of the candidates is very important, and I appreciate it very much. I especially appreciate the fact that I was endorsed by the 36th back in 2010, and that was an important endorsement for me. It was a close election as I was running against an incumbent. When I was here in 2010, I pledged that I would decide cases independently, impartially, and with integrity. I think that my record shows that I've done that. Independently, meaning not in reliance on any one group or any small group of people with a particular special interest, but independent of those interests. And I've certainly accomplished that. I think most people could look at what I've decided and like some of my decisions and dislike others as a result of really my determination to follow the legislative intent and the words of any statute. Impartially, same thing, really. Deciding without preference to anyone, working hard to put aside my own personal beliefs and follow the law. And with integrity, really conducting myself in a way that I really am able to speak to the issues and really respond without any deception or duplicity. So with that introduction, I appreciate the opportunity to be here, and I welcome your questions.
Great. So now we have our 4 prepared questions that we're asking all candidates for Supreme Court, and they're actually in front of you right there if you want to turn them over and read along as we read them aloud. These are 2-minute answers. In summary, will you do number 1?
Absolutely. What do you think were the top accomplishments of the recently completed term of the court?
I'm not really sure what term we ought to use, so I'm going to speak of what I think of the top accomplishments since I've been on the court. And without doubt, in my mind, the McClary case is one of the top accomplishments that we've accomplished. I was proud to be part of that. Our children are our future, and the state constitution, is quite clear that with the paramount duty of the state is to amply provide for the education of all children in the state. You know, when I ran for election, I told myself and I told others that I was running really to leave a better society and a more just society for our 2 children. But I realized quickly on the court that it's not just our 2 children, it's the 1.6 million children throughout the state. And that's why I'm proud of the very case. I think another special accomplishment or milestone our court has been to recognize the disparate treatment of minorities within the criminal justice system, particularly African Americans, and the disparate number of African Americans who really are in prison, who are treated really in a discriminatory manner at so many steps in the process. Not that anyone necessarily intends discrimination, but it works out that way. I've written several opinions that really focus on that, and I think that's been a major accomplishment for the court, has been to reach that, really reach out. We've been having a symposium every year since I've been on the court to talk about disparate treatment of minorities.
Great. David, number 2.
You, ironically, candidates for justice are limited in how much they can comment on cases before them. To the extent possible, could you comment a little bit further in the context of the legislative side of it?
Sure. And that's been one of the ongoing issues with the case, with the McClary case, has been the failure of the legislature to amply fund education. You know, when we decided the McClary case, we did not invent for ourselves the reforms that needed to be done. The the legislature had actually adopted a program and said, this is what it will take to adequately fund education, and we will accomplish that by 2018. So the legislature had done that. And what we did in the McLaren decision is said, go forth and do it. And unfortunately, that hasn't happened yet. And of course, with separation of powers, we can't tax. We can't order the legislature what to raise taxes or to allocate money in a particular way. That's the legislative function. The essence of the legislative function is the power of the purse. So we have encouraged the legislature. We finally did what a court does when an party disobeys a court order. We held the state in contempt. I don't know, frankly, about the latest the latest report from the legislature. It only was filed on Friday, and I'm not sure I haven't reviewed that. Eventually, we're going to continue our efforts to encourage the legislature. And I think the legislators are well-intentioned. I think that they want to see education as a paramount duty. And I think we will get there, and we will continue. By the way, I also want to say a disclaimer. I didn't really look at this second question before I answered.
What's number three?
Do you support the current system of electing judges, or do you support some other system, such as an appointment or an appointment and retention election hybrid? And if elections continue, what reform of the current campaign finance rules would you support?
Well, I think it's a theoretical question because I don't think the people of Washington are going to give up the right to vote for judges. They're not sure who they voted for in the last election or who they should vote for in the next election, but they're by golly, we're going to elect judges. I just think that's my view of it. I think that both an appointed system and a pure election system have strengths and weaknesses. And I think that what we need to do as a matter of reality is focus on how we might improve the system that we have. I personally think that a public financing system would be the ideal thing to do in Washington so that judges are freed up from having to seek through a committee to raise money. But even public financing systems are inherently difficult because the U.S. Supreme Court has struck down the Arizona system, for example, but then they have theory that I don't understand, but they did that. And so it wouldn't help as much to adopt a finance system that won't work. But that's what I would like to see as a public finance system. I think that's the main thing I would say in terms of improvement of the system. I think more information would be better. I helped to start the website votingforjudges.org, which focuses on Washington judges. I think it would help if they would acknowledge that in the voters' pamphlet so that the voters would have some place to look. And I think better financial support for that website would be an improvement, because I think it's one of the great pieces of work that we've done in terms of electing judges.
Jason, number four.
If elected, do you have any specific priorities for the court next term?
Well, I have to say the McLaren case and pushing through education funding is a priority, and I don't think that it's great to announce the rule, but if the legislature won't actually appropriate money or people won't vote to appropriate the money, then it doesn't do us much good. And so that's a huge priority, and that's one of the reasons I'm really running for re-election, is I want to stay on the court and see that through. I think the second area I would point to is one I've already mentioned, and it's the disproportionate impact of the criminal justice system on persons of color. And I would like to see us continue to work on that. In one of my cases, I called for a change in the way preemptive strikes or preemptive challenges to jurors, prospective jurors who are persons of color, the mechanism we have been using is not effective, and I called, in one of my opinions, I called for a better system. And I think that one's been proposed now, we'll see if that works. Another case, I wrote a dissent in a death penalty case arguing that with the amount of data that we have, we should have a statistically valid study to see if we are imposing the death penalty in a racially discriminatory manner. I wrote that case a few years ago. Someone responded, and the death penalty case we have before us now, and we have a statistical study that suggests that indeed it is not color blind, or that our system is not color blind. And I'd like to continue to work on that. The third area, and I'm going to run out of time here on this one, is really a terrible issue of access to justice for persons of limited means. And we've worked on that, we need to continue working on that. That's a huge gap in our justice system.
Great. So now we'll open up to follow-up questions. These are one-minute answers. And David, and then I have one. And then Jason.
Jason, why don't you go first?
How do you differentiate justice and retribution?
Here's my theory of justice. We're all in relationships with one another and with other people. When we breach an obligation that arises out of a relationship, we're in wrong relationship. And justice to me consists of bringing that relationship back into balance and back into the right relationship. One way we can do that is through restitution or retribution. That's the way we do. We restore the right relationship generally in the criminal justice system. But there are other areas as well. In civil cases, we use money. And that's not a retribution system, that's a compensation system. But to me, the essence of what we're trying to achieve in justice is to bring about right relationship so that people are in harmony and society is in harmony.
Right. David, and I'm following this up.
You're going to have an opponent,
yes,
in this race, and I just was wondering what your plan was for the campaign.
Well, it really is a continuation of what we've done so far, which is a combination of raising funds so that we can get our message out to the members of the public, and going around and meeting folks and talking to folks and talking to groups like yours. A group like this is really the heart of people who have a heart for this and who really are concerned about the process, and that's why I'm here, to get that message across. I've tried to make this a statewide campaign. I've had events in not just Seattle, but in Wenatchee and Spokane and Vancouver, Cambridge Island, where I live, in Tacoma, and we'll continue to do that throughout the state and make it a statewide action.
So you had mentioned in your priorities for the next term, access to justice for people of limited means. I was wondering if you could just take a minute to talk about what are some of the next steps, what we can do with access to justice.
I was the chair of the committee on the Supreme Court that did an update on the civil legal needs study of 2003-2004. And really identified the fact that even though we've expanded the funds that we have available for access to justice, and by that I mean representation of people of limited means, the needs have grown because the people have slipped into poverty. And so really it's a combination of things, and it's adequate funding is the main thing. Every year a member of our court joins a group that goes to Washington, D.C. to campaign for the Legal Services Corporation, which dispenses money. Another area that we haven't gotten into is the LLT program, the Limited Licensed Legal Technician, which is one effort to provide counsel for people on limited
means. Great. Summer and then Clayton.
So as a practicing attorney, one thing that is incredibly disappointing to me is the fact that there seems to be a lack of understanding or recognition by other branches of government as to what your branch of government does to interpret the laws. And just wanted to know broadly, how did you seek to try to resolve that issue?
Well, this goes back to a couple of things. One, it goes back to the question about election. And I do think that a lot of education occurs during the election process, both of other members of government, but also of the voting public. And people don't, I think, separation of powers is a concept, but when you see it in action and you see it up close and personal, that's the main thing. The other thing that I really wish that we had was more of a focus on the political system in our education system. And that includes judges, but it includes other elected positions as well. Because people need to know, how do I get, who am I, what, here's who I have in front of me, and how do I pick those people? So, and of course, the back and forth that we've had in the Clary case, every year there's a report and we issue an order. I think that we are communicating in that way.
I'm curious to what extent you feel, based upon the action or inaction of the legislature, that we are, in effect, Kansas by another name, that we are sliding towards a constitutional confrontation on that scope.
I think that we have a more divided legislature in this state, and obviously we've been very closely divided in both houses. And I think that's a difference. And we have, so, you know, you have a difference in control of the Senate and control of the House. Very closely divided again. You have the governor of another different party, and so I don't think we're quite in the position that Kansas found itself in. How will that play out? I don't know. But it's not just Kansas. Other states have had this experience too, and have applied various solutions to this, or adopted various solutions to this. I don't know what we would ultimately adopt. Couldn't
say
I
knew, but I
don't know. And so, all I can say is I promise you we'll keep working on that and keep pushing to get to where we need to be.
We have time for maybe one more question. Go ahead.
Tell us, you have a legacy that you are, I'm sure, creating on the court. And if you, let's say, leave the court in 4 or 6 years and decide it's time for you to retire, what would that legacy look like? What do you hope to have achieved?
Well, I guess one of the big things I would hope to have achieved, it goes back to this, my theory of justice.
Okay.
Because I've talked about a right relationship, and there are groups of people who are institutionally on a right relationship. And I would like to, my legacy to be to represent, not represent, because we don't represent constituencies, but to reach out and really support and protect groups. And let me give you a few examples. We've talked about already, the children, minorities, the poor. Those are the main groups that are in need of protection. And I would like to be known for having, attempted in as best I can, to protect those groups and try to bring about the right relationship of those groups with society. That's the legacy that I would
create for. All right, so we're about out of time. If you want to take 30 seconds for a closing statement.
I'm working very hard, as I indicated in answer to your question. I've been around the state and, you know, I'm encouraged by what I hear. People are, I think the public, members of the public, are very supportive of the McClary case. I think the press has been supportive of the McClary case. And I'm encouraged by that. I'm encouraged by being here and talking to you and hearing about your concerns and the questions you asked. And so I'm ready to continue against the opponent that seems
Thank you very much.